flatten ears to ground, curve shoulder into the hollow of bones of earth beneath you.
Do you understand why you've become so popular as the voice of Flinders Street Station?
Look, I can't say definitively what it is, but my theory is that it's authentic content. When I first went viral, the daughters of one of my friends said to her mother, who then relayed to me, like, she saw the videos and just went, why are people losing it over this? This is just him. This is literally just the way he is every time we see him. And I think that's the authenticity in what's happening, is that it's a guy who didn't care whether he was being filmed or not, because he was going to say the things he was saying anyway. And I mean, some of that is spurned by, you know, ADHD and autism. I didn't want to get bored for 6.5 hours standing on a platform reading the same script out over and over, the 305 train, the 307 train, 311 train. Like, I wanted to do something that was more interesting for me, that was more engaging for me. But in turn, that's also more engaging for the general public, who were just commuting through the station all the time. So, yeah, I think that's what captured people's imaginations, is that it was real. It was whatever was falling out of my mouth at the time, which, hilariously, has only gotten me into a little bit of trouble twice.
So what I see in the clips of you doing that, is, yeah, there's authenticity and relatability, but there's also a humour. And I don't, to some people it might seem like you're intentionally being humorous, but I suspect you're not. I think you're just having fun and going with something that you know and you enjoy and making it fun for yourself. And it's not like laughing at you, it's laughing at your cleverness. It's laughing at your, because it does come across as being very clever. You not aware of that?
I guess my problem might be that I've got a lot of friends in the comedy scene that I think are genuinely funny. I've had comedy clubs reach out to me and say, do you want to come and do a set? And I just go, I don't have any material for it. Like, I spend every waking moment of my life is spent working on music. So it's weird to me that, like, this thing that just falls out of my mouth on the platform is being interpreted as really well-written comedy, because in my opinion, it's not. I wouldn't dismiss the idea that people find it clever or funny, but it definitely wasn't really intended to get laugh out loud, you know, bursts from the platform like it has done, you know, over the last few months at times. You know, and like I said, I wouldn't dismiss that people enjoy it in that sense, but I've seen far too many talented and very good Melbourne comedians to put myself on that same level. So to me, it's just the ramblings of a platform announcer don't stem up to, you know, the very fine craft of people like Sez or Brett Blake or Bronwyn. Yeah.
Laurence, who's the third person or entity that you'd like to spend an hour with?
It was an entity. It was the Declaration of Irish Independence from 1916.
Wow.
And yeah.
Oh gosh, why?
There are so many reasons. I think partially because I feel like when you're a person from Australia who's not Indigenous, I feel like you live in a kind of a cultural and geographical limbo, because we're not from here, but we're not from where our parents, grandparents or great-grandparents came either, you know. And sometimes you'll have that belligerent element. They'll say, oh, I'm Australian, I'm 100% Australian, I was born here. And it's like, yeah, okay. I mean, in the modern sense of citizenry, like, I suppose I agree with you, but, you know, we are, any person who's not an Aboriginal person in Australia is a result of a journey that happened here, is a result, sometimes a horrific journey. Sometimes people died along the way. Sometimes their ancestors barely made it here, you know, like on the coffin ships, or, you know, even refugees that came, you know, via people smugglers, you know, through Indonesia in the late 90s or the early 2000s. Like, every person who's not an Aboriginal person in Australia is here as a result of a journey. Some of those journeys are more boring than others. Some of those journeys are absolutely thrilling and amazing to see. But it's over 200 years of that journey happening. you know, the result of mine, I suppose, is an Irish and Scottish heritage on one side and a Lebanese heritage on the other. And I think this is why these stereotypes of the plastic patty from America exist, like these guys from Boston who don't even describe themselves as American. They describe themselves as Irish, even though, you know, they've only been there, like, you know, they've been there for four generations straight, but that's the community of people they come through. I think sometimes living in a place, being born into a place that isn't quite yours to come from, leaves you with a sense of wanting, maybe leaves you with a sense of displacement. And that's definitely what it feels like to me. I mean, you know, I can't stand the Australian heat. I can deal with it. You know, I'm from Wagga. I can do it. I've worked in 40 degree heat on a construction site. I've done all that stuff. But when I visited Scotland, you know, nothing felt more natural to me than, you know, being in that freezing cold climate where every day I got to put on a jacket, you know, or a cap, and just, you know, the steam coming out of my breath and just feeling every minute like this is exactly what I want to feel all the time. I love dark skies. I love that freezing, icy cold wind that hits you in the morning. I love all that stuff. I visited the family castle on the west coast of Ireland in 2016, and just to see that place, you know, from where my family comes from. And I explored a lot of Irish history, and it's interesting that the commonality of the Irish experience is similar to that of the Australian one, and how interlinked those two countries are, because so many people in Australia have that Irish heritage, you know, because, you know, family members were Fenians that were, you know, arrested politically and shipped overseas to get them away from the Irish Republican Brotherhood or the Irish Republican Army or the Citizen Army. Or sometimes they were just poor people stealing a loaf of bread because under English occupation, they could barely feed their families. And so, you know, we have this inextricable link to the Celtic lands for a lot of people here, just as there's an inextricable link for a lot of people here of other heritages from other countries they came from, because this was the only option at the time, and this was the one that kept them out of harm's way. So, you know, when I read about, you know, the Irish fight for independence and how we're a part of that journey, we're a part of that fight. The 1916 Easter Uprising occurred after, you know, after at least 100 years of Irish people being thrown onto a ship and shipped out to Australia, you know, and most of them left for dead on those first, you know, 10 or so voyages, you know, because they barely had the rations to keep everyone alive. That fight was a result of their people being, you know, displaced from their own homelands, like losing their own citizenry. And, you know, I think I feel a connection to this, you know, to this foreign place that isn't quite mine, but isn't quite not mine either. And there's a mystery in that, I suppose, like a no man's land.
What audio have you chosen to go with the Declaration of Irish Independence?
I chose Roisin, Dubh. Played in the style of, I want to pronounce this correctly, Innisfree Ceoil, which is an Irish band, and the lead melody line is played by the Ilan pipes, Ilan being the Irish Gaelic word for elbow. So unlike bagpipes, which you blow into, the Irish Ilan pipes are played with your elbow. It's got a little pump there, so you don't actually use your mouth, and they play with their fingers on the flute like resonator on the instrument. So yeah, I that was what I picked.
Why that song?
And Roisin Dubh is a song of Irish resistance. It uses a metaphor because it was, you know, it was written at a time, I believe it's from the 16th century, written at a time when songs of Irish nationalism were banned and could be punishable by death. And so it's written about a lost love.
Right.
But that is the metaphor for Ireland's freedom. And it's such an old song. It's normally sung in the original Irish Gaelic language. Some people have done translations, you know, and various translations are lauded as being, you know, either more correct than others. But ultimately it's the melody that represents that sort of fight for Ireland's freedom. So I picked that. It's funny, like the first time I heard the Illan Pipes from memory was in the film Waking Ned Devine, which again came out in Australia, you know, released almost immediately to DVD, and we went down to one of those old video stores that had been converted into a DVD hiring place, you know, during the transition. And my parents hired it because, you know, it got good reviews and brought it home, and we watched that. And I think that was the first time I heard those pipes go, and something just tugged, like it was a hand plunging into my chest, just gripped my heart. And I went, oh, like, what is that? And then I forgot about it because I didn't know how to ask about it, you know. And when I was presented with bagpipes, was it this? It's like, no, it's not quite that. It's similar to that, but not quite that. And then, you know, I came down to Melbourne and got involved in the, you know, to an extent, got involved in the Irish trad scene here in Melbourne, where I'm not in the scene, but I know a lot of musos who are, and we work with them. And hearing those pipes, like in real time, in front of my face, in the flesh, was just like, oh, there's that sound. So we put that on our first album. Sordid Ordeal's first album just came out, and there's a big there's two big Illan Pipe solos in the album closing song Mishka. There's more coming up on the second album, which we're releasing this year as well. And so yeah, it's you know, it's indescribable. There's something metaphysical about the way that the sound of those pipes just grabs me. And yeah, that was you know, it's such a blatant portrayal of the song Roisin, Dubh in that recording of Innisfree. And it's to me, it's the purest example of the pipes being played in this large scale cinematic way.